We're going to get started. Welcome to Creating Advanced Gutenberg Blocks. Whoops. My name is Eric Debelak. I'm a senior developer and co-founder at 11 Online, and this year we started Block Party, which is for Gutenberg Blocks. I've been around WordPress for a long time. I tried it way back in 2004, and then started using it more in 2006. Sorry. Is this good? Okay. These days, I'm mostly a React developer. I do a lot of React, and then on the back end, we use things like Lumen, PHP, or Flask, which is a Python API framework. And then I also do Android development, and I still do WordPress. Before we get started, have people tried Gutenberg yet? Have people tried making Gutenberg blocks yet? Does anybody know React? Okay, I saw one of these, okay. So, what is Gutenberg? I'll just do a big overview, and just, there's gonna be a lot of things in here that might be super unfamiliar because Gutenberg development is unlike WordPress development as it is today. So, if everything is like unfamiliar and weird, that's okay, just kinda go with it. I'll try to introduce you to some concepts that really okay, that's okay. That will help you kind of get started and conceptualize what you're doing. But if all the code looks crazy and scary, don't worry. That's you just have to learn the syntax. Okay. Oh, don't do that. That's we have a meme of my CEO.
There you go.
It's one of these. No, I don't want that. All right. Excellent, thank you. So, you always want to have a meme of your CEO. So Gutenberg, it's when is it here? Who knows? Soon, hopefully. What you see is what you get. I mean, kind of TinyMCE is what you see is what you get, but we'll kind of go over that. This is a lot more like that. The content paradigm is blocks. Everything is a block. We're going to be writing blocks, designing blocks, little pieces of content. And it comes with a lot of simple blocks, but you can build your own, which is what we're here to talk about. And it's written in React.js. You don't need to use React.js, but you should. So it's just one of the things you're going to have to learn if you want to make Gutenberg blocks. All right, so let's have a demo. Let's see if this works. Just this is a set expectations, okay? All right, so okay, so this is the Gutenberg editor. If you haven't seen it, it's really you just come here and you choose some blocks and you say like I'm going to write a paragraph and you can add. You know, an image, or you can add, we'll add an image of my CEO, who I love. But this is very similar to what we're used to, right? Like, it kind of feels like TinyMCE, no big deal. There's some things that are nice, like you can rearrange things. They're working on some drag and drop stuff. There's all the extra settings are on the right-hand side. But I think where Gutenberg gets really interesting is not in just how it replaces TinyMCE, but it's the additional possibilities that it opens up for us. Because it is a what you see is what you get editor that you interact with. You're not using shortcodes. You're able to do something way more interesting, and I'll give you an example of a pie chart. So I'm from New Mexico. So we're gonna talk, we'll make a pie chart on chili. If you ever visit Albuquerque, you're gonna get a question at every restaurant, which is red, green, or Christmas, okay? Red chili, green chili, or both of them. So we'll just do a little pie chart with chili. We'll assume that there's some voting going on. We'll add another slice. Okay, we'll say, I don't know, 35 people want green chili, and then, give that orange. Okay. So, I mean, that's pretty different. And then we can come over here and adjust the size a little bit, and you can say, oh, I want to change the labels, right? I want to make it 3D. How about spin it around, give it a donut hole, right? This is what Gutenberg opens up for us. And this is where I think Gutenberg gets exciting. All right. Did I convince you that it's exciting? Are you excited? I'm excited. Okay, so some basics. Gutenberg puts everything in the content. It's the, you know, the content box or block, or you use it in templates with the content. So you can say, with some caveats, goodbye to PostMeta. If you're used to developing sites using a lot of PostMeta, you don't need that anymore. Well, with some caveats. You still might want it for searching or for some other things, but for the most part, you don't need to use PostMeta for all these different fields. Gutenberg uses attributes as settings on each block, and then there's a lot of good resources, and we'll kind of go over all this stuff in more detail. When you register a block, the block is basically two things. It's an edit method and a save method. And what the save method does is it takes all your attributes, which are all those settings, and it saves it as HTML. And so it might look like this. So this is what's what gets saved in the content of in the page content. And then if you have attributes, there's two ways of dealing with attributes. Attributes can either be attached to an HTML element, or they're saved as JSON in HTML comments, which is a kind of weird way of doing it, but it works really well. So like if we have like a pricing table block here, and then all this is our data associated with that block, just as an HTML comment. You don't see it on the front end. This gets pulled out, I assume using some filter, and all you get is the HTML. On the editor side, Gutenberg takes those attributes, parses them, and then it creates that editor method, that editor component, using those attributes. And then what the editor method does is that's what allows you to interact and like make all those changes, like I was doing. And like I said, the front end of the site just shows the saved content. So we'll just do a really simple example to conceptualize this, and then we'll get into more interesting things. So this is the register block function. This is JavaScript. You set some default attributes, which attributes, again, that's your settings. And Gutenberg does validation where it says, based on your attributes, does your save methods HTML match what I think it should be? So you always need to declare these, otherwise it will break the validation. Here's our edit method, okay? Pretty simple. Again, this is React. You have some built-in stuff that you get that are passed in as parameters. And then we have this very simple method, which all we're just doing is we're saying, is this selected? If it is, we're gonna show one of the built-in plain text inputs. If it's not selected, we'll just show a p tag with the text. The plain text method has an onChange, which uses the built-in set attributes to change the attribute, okay? And then the save method, remember this is what saves your HTML, very simple. Save a p tag with your text. Okay. So a lot of React, kind of tooling around React, is complicated because you have to compile everything and use Webpack or Babel. But there, Create Guten Block is a really useful tool because it does all that for you. Once you install it, is everybody familiar with NPM? Okay, some people are shaking their heads. All right, NPM. If you don't know that, you'll need to get used to that. That is the new world of WordPress. So NPM, once you have it installed, create Guten block, you name it, CD into it, and then you run start, and it will run a watcher. So as you make changes, it will recompile your code as you go. So what's built in? Gutenberg, one really nice thing about Gutenberg is there's tons of stuff that's built in, it's just ready to go for you. Set attributes, again, that's what deals with changing your settings, and it also is what tells the editor that you can save the page. Until you run set attributes, you can't save the page because it doesn't think anything has changed. So that is that comes with it. Is selected tells you is the user selected this block to interact with it or not. There's tons of built-in editor components. In our example, we had plain text, there's rich text, media upload, color palette, dropdown, inner blocks, and the list goes on and on. So there's, if you go to the GitHub repo of Gutenberg, they have two different types of components. One is just components and the other is blocks. So if you kind of look in there, those are all things that you can import into your project and just use right out of the box. Let's say you want more. If you're not familiar with NPM, it's Node Package Manager. Because we're writing in JavaScript, you can use NPM to install any package you want. One thing, for example, that we've done is there's some weirdness with the color palette. If you put the color palette in a dropdown, they have a custom color palette that's another dropdown, and you can't put a dropdown in their dropdown. So all we did is we looked at, okay, what NPM package are they using for their custom color picker? We imported that and did our own implementation of it, and it took maybe 20 minutes, right? 650,000 packages, you can probably find whatever you need on NPM. Okay, so now we're gonna get into some simple, I shouldn't call them, they're maybe not that simple. They're as simple as I could make them to cover a lot of the concepts that really show what can we do to make some really exciting blocks. So we're gonna start with simple statistics. So our goals are, is we wanna make a simple statistic block that allows users to input as many statistics as they want, okay? And then just have it count up when it appears on the page. Okay, not too complicated. So what are some strategies that we want to use? Okay, we need to have attributes, but since we don't know how many statistics people are going to use, we won't need to have an array of attributes, right? So we can have some flexibility in the number of statistics people put in. And since Gutenberg only saves HTML in the content, we don't get any of the JavaScript interactivity on the front end. So we need to do something to overcome that. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna use data attributes, and then we'll write a jQuery script to parse those attributes and start the count up animation. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, so when we get the file structure of create Guten block, we get a directory called src, which is where we do all of our editing. And we have an init.php file. And this will look like, if you're used to plugin development, this is gonna be everything that you've always been used to, okay? What do we do? We're gonna just enqueue some styles and scripts. In this one, you get some basic, the create Gutenberg block stuff comes with some styles that are editor specific and front end specific. And there's one function that will load things on both the front end and the back end, and another one that will just do the back or the dashboard. So we have a countup library, right, that we just pulled from GitHub, an appear library that just is looking to see, okay, when does this element appear on the page, and then we have our custom countup JavaScript that parses and starts the countup animation. And then for the editor side, we have the block, JS, which that's the React stuff, right? That's the only place on the site by default that you'll load React is in the dashboard. And that's where you get all that interaction. And then we have just some editor CSS. So that's our PHP file, our main PHP file, just enqueuing some stuff. And then we move to our SRC block, block.js. This is where all the React stuff happens. At the top of the file, we're just importing some of these styles, right? We're importing I18.9, which is the internationalization stuff. And then we start importing stuff from the WP Global. So the WP Global, if you're not familiar with it, you might have used it for the API. if you just go in your console, in your browser on a WordPress site and do console log WP or just type in WP, you can see tons and tons of stuff that's associated with that. With Gutenberg, it adds all the blocks and components and everything to this WP global. So we're just gonna import some things, register block type, that's what we need to start, and we'll import our plain text, okay? Am I going too fast? Everybody, thumbs up, thumbs down? No? Okay, saw one thumbs up. All right. We're gonna register our block. Okay, again, everything here out of this, from the create Guten block, I only added this last line here. So when you do this, it builds a working project for you, and you can just start playing with it from there. We're gonna give it a title, and that's how you find it when you press that little plus button. Actually, do you know, I should show you guys what this looks like before I go into all the code. Let's see, where did my browser go? Okay. Oh, and by the way, when you update it, just to show that it does look the same on the front end as it does on the back end. Okay, so simple statistics, right? It's gonna be really simple. What do we want? Here's something a lot of sites, you know, put on, I don't know. I never know what to put in here. We'll say it takes a lot of time, a lot of cups of coffee to make some websites. Okay? Right, and then the front end, same deal. Okay. That all make sense? Okay. So, all we need to kind of get started is all the stuff up through keywords is to help people find it. So there's a few ways in Gutenberg that you can find your blocks. You can actually do, I think it's /, and then you can start typing. And so you don't have to go and press that little plus button to add blocks. There's little shortcuts on the right-hand side. There's 3 or 4 ways to get it. And depending on how you do it, you either would use the keywords, like statistics, or the title. And then you can have an icon, and there's different categories like embeds, and I always seem to use common. And then we set up our default attributes. Again, we don't want to break the validation. We need to let Gutenberg know what kind of attributes we're expecting. So we have our stats array, simple. You can't, you cannot define like attributes within an array, like if you have a array of objects, you can't do that, so you just have to go with just an array, and you can put whatever you want in there. And then a random key, which all we're using the random key for is so that we have unique IDs on the front end when we're starting our animations. Okay, now we'll kind of go through the edit method. Again, you know, all these parameters, these are just things we get for free with Gutenberg. When we do the edit method, we're just gonna check to see if the random key is what we set as a default, otherwise we're gonna make a new random key. When you're writing React, if you haven't written React, everything that you do is a component, and you tend to organize your code in these little chunks that do one thing. So you'll see as we go through these, that's what we're gonna be doing. We're gonna be making these little tiny blocks of code that do one thing. And they're just defined as constants. Again, I don't wanna get into like ES6 and React too much. Hopefully it will at least be readable if you're not used to it. There's a lot of conveniences in shorthand. So we're gonna make an add row button. Basically all this is a button. Does this have a pointer too? Which button?
Red line.
Red line? Oh, okay, nice. Fancy. Basically all this button does is it has an onClick method that it puts a new stat at the end of our stats, and then it sets an attribute to our new stats. So we're using set attributes, saying, let's just add an empty object at the end. One gotcha if you're not used to JavaScript development, JavaScript is passed by reference, so you need to make new variables instead of just modifying the variables, the attributes that you already have. Okay, because how JavaScript works is it says, oh, the reference to this variable is the same, it didn't change. So you need to make a new variable. So that's all we have, right? It's a button, onClick, we add some new stats to the stats array, and then we set it. DeleteStat works much the same way. It's just a button, onClick, whoops, wrong button, onClick. We're going to use slice, and we're going to take out the attribute that, or the stat that we don't want anymore. And again, using set attributes. And then we're going to make some just convenience methods, which is render plain text to, we're just making a more flexible function that can take in what type of field it is and what the index is, and make an input for us that will save to the right piece of data in the stats array. Right, again, on change, we're just, you'll see a lot of things use the on change method. So we'll kind of go over that more in the other example. And then we have another method just to start the count up animation in the dashboard. One thing you'll notice with a lot of React stuff in general, and Gutenberg is no exception, is there is some duplication of effort. We have kind of our editor side, our editor animation, but we also have to make another set of that for the front-end experience. So this just uses a library, you know, it's nothing too fancy. And then the main part is always the return. So in React, whatever you return is the HTML that's being shown. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our stats that are again part of that attribute global that, or the attribute object that gets passed in. We're going to map through them, which just goes through each item in the array. If it's not selected, we'll start the count up. If it is selected, then we'll do the different pieces of it. So if it's selected, we're going to use our helper method to make a plain text input. Otherwise, we're just going to show some HTML. And the same thing for the label. Okay? And then if it is selected again, we're going to show delete stats so that you can delete the stats that you want. Is this all conceptually making sense? Yeah? Good? Okay. And then at the bottom again, we'll just say, are we selected? If so, we'll add a row. Okay. We'll do the add row button. So it's really not that much code, right? I don't think it's a lot of code. If you can imagine writing that in jQuery, you'd probably write 10 times the amount of code. Save function is very similar. All we do, have some HTML, map through the stats, put them on the page. Okay. So I didn't show you some of the code, like I have the thing that parses out, actually, that's one thing we should talk about quickly. Is, you know, again, since we don't have that interaction, we don't have JavaScript on the front end, all we're doing is we're passing in the stat value as a data attribute, right? Because otherwise we don't know what the countup value is. And then if you look on GitHub, you can see I have that countup.js. All it does is it goes through each element with a class name of simple statistic countup, gets that value, and starts the countup animation, okay? So what are our goals, right? We wanted users to put in as many statistics as they wanted and have a simple countup animation. So our strategy is we use an array to allow flexibility, and then we use data attributes to save that count up data so that we can parse it on the front end with a jQuery script. Okay. All right, how are we doing? You guys feeling, is this drinking from a fire hose? Is it? Okay. All right, so now let's look at something that's gonna feel more familiar, I think, for a lot of people, which is a weather block, simple weather block. All right. So let's kind of take a look at what this is. We'll do weather here. So we have a few things in this weather block. We have some unit settings, right? We can change it to see if we want. We have an API key. This is for open weather API. And then we have a city input that allows us to say, what city do we want the weather for? And we have some methods to save the API key. And then on the front end, we'll see the same thing, okay? So this, nothing too complicated, but this will feel more familiar, hopefully, if you're used to developing plugins. Again, all the code's available here. So what are our goals for this one? Okay, we want to save our open weather API globally. We don't need a user to put in their API key every time they want a weather widget, okay? But then we do want users to set their temperature and weather units, or their temperature units and city per block, okay? All right, so some strategies here. We're gonna use server-side rendering. Gutenberg allows server-side rendering, right? Which opens up a lot more possibilities for us. And why do we want server-side rendering? I don't want people using my open weather API key, okay? We're gonna save the API key on the WP options table all through Gutenberg so that all weather blocks have access to it. We're gonna use those right-hand side controls like I showed you for the temperature unit, and then we're gonna use a full React component for the edit method so we have access to the React lifecycle. The React lifecycle has a bunch of different methods that get called depending on what happens, like did the component mount, did it update? If you're familiar with, there's a bunch of, like Android development does the same thing, iOS development does the same thing, if you're familiar with any of those things. So we're gonna start again with src/init, and we have similar things, right? We're gonna enqueue some styles, okay? Include for the dashboard only, we're gonna do our block.js again, we're gonna enqueue that, and enqueue our editor CSS. Hopefully this stuff is familiar for you guys. We're gonna register our setting so that we can save the setting on the options table. Okay, this is all just standard WordPress stuff. And now we're going to get to the server-side rendering stuff. So, Gutenberg has this method register block type that also exists in PHP. So you can register a block in JavaScript, PHP, or both. And so on this instance, we're gonna use the PHP version because it gives us this render callback method to say what function do we want to call when we want to render our block. Otherwise, it's very similar. You don't do the names and stuff and the icons in PHP, but you do have to define your attributes. And so then let's look at our render block. This is just a very basic API request. We say, okay, let's get our API key from the database. If the attributes, we get the parameter of attributes, which is an associative array. If the attributes has a city and we have an API key, we're gonna make an API request to open weather. We build our URL, use WP remote get, decode the stuff we get back, and then we're just gonna make a little convenience thing for if people don't wanna see metric imperial, let's show them CF or Kelvin. And then once we have our weather, we just return some HTML. That's all we have. So hopefully this, you know, if you guys are used to developing plugins or things like that for WordPress, this shouldn't feel unfamiliar. Is it, right? You guys good with that? Okay. All right, so the JavaScript side will be probably less familiar, but we're gonna just do the same thing that we've been doing, right? We're at the top, we're gonna use the built-in stuff, we're gonna import it. In this case, we're using a simple debounce if you're not used to debouncing, do you guys know what debouncing is? No, I guess? No? Okay, so debouncing is a way to delay when a function is called. So what it will do is it's kind of like, in a sense, you're kind of like listening to say, has this changed a lot of times? And if it has, I'm not going to call this function until it stops changing. So people commonly will use this for like scrolling, or you know, if you're doing scroll events and stuff like that, so you don't call too many events in the browser. We're gonna do it so we don't make too many API requests when we're typing in the name of the city and run out of our rate limit for the day. So again, we have to register our block type just like we did before. We don't need to say what our attributes are. We already did that. This is all similar. But in this case, instead of having an edit method, we're going to use a React component. React components technically are a function. So Gutenberg will be able to use a React component in edit instead of having a function. And we'll go over that last. And since we're doing server-side rendering, this will be the easiest part. Return null. We don't want anything to be saved because we're going to deal with that on the server in PHP. Okay. So if you've done any React, this will look really familiar. If you haven't, I'm sorry that this is, it might be overwhelming. But we have our editor. We have our component, which we've imported at the top. This is a WordPress, or Gutenberg has a wrapper around the typical React component as an abstraction so that if React changes their component API, WordPress will deal with that, or Gutenberg, I should say, soon to be WordPress, will deal with that for us so that it won't break whatever we've been building in Gutenberg. So they can provide that. They provide that layer of abstraction to prevent any kind of breaking issues. When you have a React component, you have something called state. React is basically a state machine, if you're familiar with that concept. If you're not, what that means is instead of manipulating each little thing on the screen, you just change your state, and then from that, everything else responds. So you're only changing the state, and then whatever you have just changes. So we have some state. Why do we want state? Right, this state is local to the component. Why do we want that and not saving attributes? Well, the big reason is that the weather is going to change, right? So we don't want to save the weather as an attribute because it's going to change every, I don't know, how often does it change here? Every 5 minutes? So we want this to be saved locally, but not be available on the next page refresh. Okay, for the dashboard. And then we set our weather API just to an empty string and then is saving to false, which will be for a button animation. All right, now we start to get into the life cycle. Component did mount. When the component mounts, what do we want to do? We're going to use the WP global, and we're going to use the WP API to get our API key. Okay, if you've done stuff with using WP API in JavaScript, this should look really familiar. These are all methods just built into WordPress ever since the API became a part of core. So what we're gonna do, we're gonna get our setting, and then we're gonna save it to our state so that our component now, as it mounts, gets the key, saves it to the state, so now we have access to this API key. And then when the component did update, this will run many times. Whenever anything changes, this will run. So we're just gonna do some simple checks so that we don't get the weather constantly. We're gonna say, okay, did the city change? If the city didn't change, or the units didn't change, or if we don't already have weather, or we don't already have an API key, we're just not gonna do anything, okay? So component did mount, just like a lot of other React lifecycle methods, has a lot of parameters that get passed in automatically, like what were the previous props, which that's an inheritance thing, what's the previous state, that's again the state that is local to that component. We're gonna make save API key. This again is using all the stuff that's been in core since the REST API. You know, this is all documented really well on the handbook, so just take a look at how some of this stuff works. One difference is that we're going to use this set state. So set state, kind of like set attributes, is that's a React, set state is a React thing, and that will just allow us, that's the method that's given to each component to save the state. And all we're doing there is saying, okay, we're saving, now we're done saving. And then, now here's, again, remember what I said is you can't save something until the attributes change. So we have to do this really dumb thing, which is if we're just changing the state, we still want to allow the user to save the post. So we have to do just a dumb thing to tell, hey Gutenberg, there's been a change here. Okay, get weather. Here we have more duplication of effort, unfortunately, but we want to repeat our method of getting the weather in PHP and do it in JavaScript so that the people who are interacting with the dashboard can see the weather, can see that it's working, see that their API key is valid. This basically works the same way. I wrote the API request in jQuery because I thought that might be more familiar. Otherwise, it's all the same. Again, this we're debouncing this function so we don't call it more than until it stops being called for 1 second. So that's what the 1,000 milliseconds is at the end over there. Okay, and then we have our render method. Again, render is what gets shown. That's the HTML that we see. And this is all pretty basic. Same thing as what we did in PHP, right? But we're doing it again in JavaScript. But we do have this other thing, which is our controls. So React, when it returns, you'll see two different ways that React will do this. It'll be parentheses, which is when you're returning a single element, or you need to have an array because you can return an array of elements. React does not like it if there's two adjacent elements that it's returning in a component. So you either have to use an array or just use a single HTML element where everything else is the child. Inspector controls is, again, a built-in thing. That's what's on the right-hand side. That gives us everything that we need when you select a component or a block. That's our right-hand side controls. So again, we're going to use isSelected. What's unfortunate about Gutenberg is that the inspector controls are global to all blocks on the page. So if you don't use isSelected, your controls are going to show no matter what's selected. I don't know why that's the case, but that's how it is. So inspector controls are global to the page. We're going to just use some built-in things, which we'll go over in more detail. Right, select control, again, Gutenberg provides all this for us. It's really nice. You have a select control, you pass in your options. On change, you use set attributes. Okay. We have our text control, which this is what's going to this is going to set the state for our API key so that we can save it locally. And then when you click on the button, that saves the API key to the database. And then it provides this helpful isBusy, which is just pulled from the state. Okay, does that make sense? Feeling good? Everybody's good? 10 minutes? All right. Okay. And then when we are, this is further down in the render, this is that second item in the array. Again, we'll say, is it selected? If it is, we'll show a text control where they can set the city. Right? Starting to see some patterns. Use on change, set attributes. And then we just down below is we say, if we have weather, let's show it. Otherwise, we'll show no weather. And then this is just in detail, so you can see. I forgot that I put this in. But this is just bigger, basically. So again, what are our goals, right? We wanted to allow users to globally save the open weather API key. but then set their other controls based on the block. We use server-side rendering so we don't expose our API key. And we saved our API key on the options table, used inspector controls, and we used the React lifecycle. Okay, so there are a lot of gotchas with Gutenberg. Gutenberg's a moving target. I found out yesterday morning in the airport that they released a breaking change, and I had to update my slides and code examples. Luckily, it wasn't big. It's getting better, though. Every release is getting better. Validation is one that trips up a lot of people in the beginning because, like I said, Gutenberg revalidates every block. It wants to know that your HTML matches your attributes. And if you're doing things that are more complex, like some of these examples, and you're saving those attributes as JSON in the HTML comments, it's going to say, do these two things match? If it doesn't think it matches, it says, whoa, this is wrong, and this is bad. We're not gonna let you re-render this block or this code as your block. You'll have to change it with some custom HTML. But the best way to get around this is you use those default attributes. And in the future, when you make changes to your blocks, there's also a deprecated block method that's optional when you register the block. And that's an array where you can put in all your deprecated blocks so that what it will do is say, hey, this doesn't match what I think it should be. Then it will start running through the deprecated blocks until it finds one that matches. Arrays don't allow for declaration of sub-attributes, which is good and bad. If you're used to maybe like MySQL or strongly typed languages, you might think it's bad. If you use JavaScript, it's kind of like anything goes anyway. Or like Mongo, just throw anything you want in there. That's kind of how arrays work. Set attributes is another gotcha. It has no callback. Unlike set state for React, which has a callback, set attributes doesn't have a callback, which means, if you're not familiar with that term, is you can't, a callback is usually an anonymous function that gets passed in as soon as the first function is completed. So Gutenberg doesn't let us know when set attributes is done, unfortunately. So that's kind of a hassle. You have to play around with how you want to do that. Using out-of-the-box components don't really look like the front end, unfortunately. But that's one reason why I like to use isSelected and show either the edit component when they're selecting it and otherwise just show HTML so that users will have a better sense of what will the HTML actually look like when they are building their page. And there's inner blocks. Inner blocks are nested. So you can make a block that has basically total freedom for other blocks to be thrown in there. The one downside to inner blocks is the inner blocks are global per block. So if you can't use three inner blocks, right? Because then all that content will be in all three places. You can only use one per component, one per block. The other great thing that has me excited about Gutenberg is templating. Templating, like if you're used to using custom post types, this should look familiar, but there's some extra things in there like template, which is an array of Gutenberg blocks. So now when you're building client sites and you have something like you're building locations or whatever it is, or team members, when they open up that page, if you're using this templating, there will be a Gutenberg page filled out with all the blocks and some default content if you want, and all they need to do is click into them and change the content. And there's even controls like template lock where you can allow them to not add or move anything. So that was a lot of information, right? 5 minutes. What questions do you guys have? Yes.
You're saying all the data is put as an HTML comment.
Yeah.
So if one was using like a custom post type, how would you populate these attributes on the form kind of programmatically?
So that's with the templating. So in here you can, this is just an associative array and you can add extra things to it. So, and on all the attributes for your blocks, you can put in defaults. So if you wanted to, for any block, you can put in some default content. Any other questions? So for those of you who had never seen ES6 or React, was it conceptually, did it make sense, the things we were doing? Yeah? Okay. I encourage you to look at the repos, right? Those are there. You know, fork them, do whatever you want. I tried to choose the simple examples that covered a lot of different areas of Gutenberg development so that you can kind of see, building off of those two things, you can, like, there's a lot of permutations of other cool things that you can do. So, yes. I think so. Yeah. 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 So it depends, right? I think, you know, like, we've been building custom blocks because we think it's a big opportunity. But I do think that if you, so I would say it's kind of a double-edged sword, right? Because like that pie chart block I showed you, you can kind of go nuts and do whatever you want. You can choose all the colors and you can, you know, that might not be what you want for a client site. What you might want for a client site is no options or maybe a few options, right? So they don't go crazy and mess up the site. So I think that there's kind of maybe two different approaches. One will be infinite customization, right? Change the border radius, change all the colors, the fonts are gonna be pulled in from the theme. And the other approach is I'm gonna build blocks for the branding guidelines of my clients. And I might say, like, let's say I have a call to action block. Maybe I'll let them choose from 3 background colors, or maybe I'd let them choose from, you know, have an image to the right or an image to the left, but I'm not gonna give them infinite customization. So I think in some ways, there will always be people who, if they have strict branding guidelines, you'll always be developing custom blocks because, and I can show you quick, how the default blocks are really customizable. So let's take a look at the paragraph one, and I'll just put in some lorem ipsum. Okay, so what can I do? I can change all this stuff, right? Make it as big as I want. I can do this. I can make this unbelievably ugly if I want to, right? No. So this is, you don't want your clients doing this, right? So I think there will always be, there's gonna be a big need for custom Gutenberg block development to match those branding guidelines. This is the default paragraph one. Yeah. Yes. Yes, I agree. But thankfully, I mean, hopefully I've shown you that, you know, that simple, that first simple example, that wasn't that complicated. And what you can do then, so you don't need to give them any of this. You can I forget how you do it, but you can deregister some blocks. So what I anticipate doing is we're going to definitely either deregister all this stuff or just have our own, right? And so, but thankfully it's not that hard because everything is there. This is, the p tag is basically the rich text component wrapped in a p tag. Yeah. I don't believe it does in Gutenberg. So You know, the one thing with Gutenberg is it's really, it's not geared for people that make client sites in a lot of ways. The defaults are built for people who might want this, right? It's built for just users, that it's more of a, you know, Squarespace type of experience. So I think that, yeah, I think there's always gonna be a lot of work in making blocks that meet branding guidelines. So hopefully, you know, my talk was a lot about more of the advanced stuff, but hopefully in the beginning you kind of saw that that side doesn't need to be scary. You could just throw in a rich text block and have your own CSS, and if you don't put this stuff in, it's not there. So at least that's encouraging. Yes. Yeah, so there's a column. Yeah, there's a column block it's still officially experimental. It uses inner blocks, but yeah, it's still experimental. But you can, you know, add, you know, something here, and then you add something, another pair. I always forget how this thing works. Oh, okay, yeah, just like that. So you can put in columns, and then there's, I forget how you change the settings. Some of this stuff is still needs some work. Yeah, exactly. We're gonna do once 5.0 comes out, every new site is in Gutenberg.
You're gonna do it immediately.
Yeah.
What was the decision behind that?
I think that you know, our clients use a lot of custom fields, and post-meta is, you know, why do we use post-meta? It's because it's the only thing available to us. It's not a great solution. It's excluded from search. It's, you know, it has a lot of performance concerns. So I think that switch away from post-meta and a better experience of not like some, here's a list of all the fields and you don't really know what it's gonna look like. We can just make a template, they put their content in. I think it's gonna be a much, much better client experience.
Are you gonna just roll it out in that public one, or email campaign, blog post, demos, like?
It depends. I think it depends on what the previous experience is with WordPress. I think that Gutenberg is going to be, the templates are going to be great. I think that for people who use WordPress a lot, let's say they're in their site 3 times a week, they're going to be able to use Gutenberg well. I think that the people who maybe log in once a month, Gutenberg is going to be more confusing. Until maybe some things change, you know, there's a lot of, what does this stuff mean? You know, what does that plus mean? And until they kind of get, I think you have to use it. Even see, you saw I got confused with it. So, I mean, we use CMB2, but I just talked with the CMB2 guy. I'm interested in working with him on some things because I think there still is a place for post-meta. Maybe there's going to be a wrapper that allows you to save data into a Gutenberg field and into post-meta, because it's useful sometimes to have that data to get all the doctors at this location, or, you know, maybe it's a wrapper around taxonomies instead. But I think there's going to be definitely some use cases to do some of that stuff. Well, there are Gutenberg-enabled themes, and you can do